Now we're on.
Now we're on.
Check, check. One, two.
Now we're on.
One, two.
What was the song?
Immediate keep on my mama, Victoria Monet.
Oh, yeah. Duh. Gotta keep that one. I went through some Monet songs this weekend. Jaguar, Ass Like That, Friend You Can Keep. Like, Victoria Monet.
Monopoly.
Oh.
One of my faves.
Is Monopoly on the most recent?
No.
Okay.
Monopoly was like two. It was on her first album.
Okay. Jaguar part one.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
It's only a 3-minute song.
Yes.
I hit every light on my way. So I had another song coming into the garage. And it was a fever dream of a song.
What was it?
Are you familiar with a band called Cobra Starship?
No.
I feel like Cobra Starship absolutely existed. They had two wildly popular songs. But what happened to Cobra Starship? The song is Hot Mess. I think it was used in a Gossip Girl episode, but I went back and I was looking at the music video, and I don't understand how they got away with this music video because they're basically just like kidnapping girls and throwing them in a truck.
Oh.
And taking them to the club.
Let's go. No Diddy.
No Diddy.
No doubt.
Just a hot mess, and I'm falling for you.
Does,
the other song
it
is
does,
good.
Jacob does bring up a good point. That does sort
that
of
does
sound,
kinda sound
like
it actually might Diddy. Be like, yes, Diddy. The other song is Good Girls Go Bad.
Mm.
I make them good girls go bad.
I know
make them
about.
Good girls go bad.
I don't know the words to it. I just know that
I
little
know
part.
Your style. Yeah, you're
I usually
girl.
I usually skip it when it comes on. Did you delete it?
No, I kept it because it took me back to a joyous place. I don't know what story to vote on today. I'll figure it out.
It's good stuff.
I'll figure it out. What's up, everybody? It is, whoa, that was John Moran. It is Wednesday, April 10th. It is going to be a good day. Jessica Benson with you from the Grind City Media Studios in Memphis, Tennessee on this rainy midweek show here in Memphis. CJ Hurt behind the glass coming up on today's show. Another record was set for the Memphis Grizzlies last night. They are not good records, but they are records nonetheless. And we will talk about them. Three games remain. They played last night here in Memphis. They played tonight in Cleveland. It was a crazy night around the NBA overall. Some good news for Giannis Antetokounmpo and the Bucks this morning. We will show you one of the worst plays you will ever see from the NBA. We'll do a little oops, we missed it again stories from the week we have not gotten to. The numbers came out and the women's championship game beat the viewership of the men's championship game for the first time ever. Also, one of the greatest of all times in the sport of college basketball announced her retirement last night. D'Angelo Williams will join us about 50 minutes in. We never know what we'll talk to him about, and then we will end with some story time. Be sure to vote on today's story. If you are joining us live in the chat, hit that like button, subscribe to Grind City Media, and then we'll do some WTF stories as well, including hypersexual zombie cicadas. They're coming to the South this summer. And a story that CJ wants to talk about, but we will not be talking about. I will keep him from being great. It's a Wednesday. It's always fun. Let's go.
Looking for the hot hand. Jaren got the step, got the flush. There's no layups on that one.
Electric, rowdy, intense. They bring the same mentality that they bring anywhere into the building. If they were mad about something, they're bringing it in. If they were happy about something, they're bringing it in. So we need all that energy times a thousand.
Real country music. With Cody Johnson, live. Saturday, April 13th at FedEx Forum. Country's best. The Leather Tour. With Cody Johnson. With special guest Justin Moore. Also featuring Drake Milligan. VIP and reserve seats on sale at Ticketmaster.com in the FedEx Forum box office. Cody Johnson.
Hey Grizzlies fans, after exciting hoops and a lucky night of gaming, where do you rest your head? Look no further than Southland Casino Hotel, proud sponsor of the Memphis Grizzlies. Our high-rise hotel is the epitome of luxury and comfort. Picture this, you've just finished an evening of gaming and dining, so you head on over to one of our 300 rooms to end the night. Choose from standard, suite, and presidential suite, plus we're pet-friendly and offer mobility scooters for rent. It's a seamless experience for everyone. And don't miss the Main Street Exchange, right in the heart of our casino lobby. Whether you're craving a snack back or need a souvenir of your stay, we've got you covered. From polo shirts to shot glasses, take a piece of the Southland excitement home with you. So come stay and play at Southland Casino Hotel, where every moment is designed for your enjoyment. Book your hotel stay by calling 833-703-3350 or visit online at southlandcasinohotel.com/hotel.
Guests must be 21 years of age or older to check in at hotel. Must be 21 plus. Play responsibly. For help quitting, call 800-522-4700.
Maxwell in concert. The Serenade Tour. October 16th at FedEx Forum. Maxwell. With special guest Jasmine Sullivan. And October London. Tickets on sale now at livenation.com. Don't miss Maxwell Live.
Nate Bargatze, the Be Funny Tour.
I mean, Chuck E. Cheese is rough. I don't know if you've been there in a while. They look like they're trying to go to business and they can't.
All new material.
They filed for bankruptcy and they're still open. They called Blockbuster and they're like, how do you get out? We want out.
Nate Bargatze,
Friday, May 31st, FedEx Forum. Tickets available at FedEx Forum Box Office or Ticketmaster.com. Produced by Outback Presents.
Nate Bargatze, the Be Funny Tour.
Don't worry, Be Fluffy World Tour.
The minute you get into a brand new relationship, like magic, you know who really notices just how happy you are, guys? Other women, not your woman. Look how happy he is. Oh, I bet I can change that.
Friday, May 10th, FedEx Forum. Get your tickets now at FluffyGuy.com. Don't miss a Memphis. Don't worry, Be Fluffy World Tour.
Presents The Jessica Benson Show with CJ Hertz, live from the Grind City Media Studios on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
What's up, everybody? It is Wednesday. I hope you're having a great start to your week, going into a great end to your week. CJ, you know, I did not burn my eyeballs with the eclipse because we always use protection.
Use protection or you're burning your balls.
Facts. I did burn my eyeballs watching the third quarter of the Grizzlies-Spurs game last night.
Wait, you told me yesterday you had a riddle also.
Yeah, that's later.
That's later. Okay, cool. Yeah, that third quarter
unless
was
you want to start with the riddle?
Jessica, it's your show. Like, can we zoom in? Because she routinely forgets what the name of the show is. It's a Jessica Benson show, dog. Whatever you do is fine. I'm just riding your coattail.
I like to have reassurance, okay? I like to ask questions. I like to make sure we are a team, and I like to make sure we're all in this together.
Wait, T is for Troy. Wait.
Burr, 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 burr.
You're Troy, what's his last name?
Bolton.
You're Troy Bolton.
I have my head in the game.
And I'm one of the extras that they only bring in to like dance in the background. We're on the team. We're on the same team technically, but it's very clear you're the star and you're the starter and I'm on the bench.
You're Corbin.
No.
Corbin Blue.
No.
Yes, you are.
No, Corbin is way too good at what he's doing to be compared to me and what I do. Again, I'm
honestly,
one of the
Will
extras.
Coleman is more of the Corbin Blue of the show because he bakes and played basketball, so that's more of a natural fit.
Yep. I'm dancer number four.
You're like Sharpay's brother.
Who?
You're Ryan.
No, I don't have a name.
Okay, we have way too much for me to go through the High School Musical.
Whatchamacallit?
The riddle?
The third quarter. Whatever you want to do. Riddle or the third quarter. It's your show.
Well,
again.
The third quarter was a complete riddle in which the Grizzlies only scored 12 points against the Spurs last night. Listen, we'll start with Grizzlies Spurs because we don't have that many Grizzlies games that we all have to all be in together for the rest of this season. Three games remain. They play the Cavs in Cleveland tonight. But last night, here at FedEx Forum, I silly me, joke's on me. It was a 1-point game at the half. And if we're being completely honest, you're looking at the last limping into the end of the regular season for the Grizzlies, and they're taking on a Spurs team that has Victor Wembanyama out on the court with no minutes restriction now, and it's always exciting to have the opportunity to see Victor Wembanyama, but it's a 1-point game at half, and I was like, you know what? This could be a really fun game down the stretch. Maybe we get a cool, like, Victor Wembanyama, Brandon Clark kind of moment. Maybe a Trey Jemison with Victor Wembanyama moment of it all. And then the third quarter comes and the Grizzlies score 12 points. And I was like, well, cool. Against the Spurs.
Didn't they hold the Spurs to like 13 in the first quarter?
Spurs, yes.
Yeah,
16.
16. Okay.
The Spurs. That was the Spurs' 20th win. The Spurs with, yes, rookie of the year, Victor Wembanyama. And after last night, I'm willing to flirt with the notion that Victor Wembanyama also should be defensive player of the year. He will not be defensive player of the year. It will more than likely go to Rudy Gobert. But there is a case to be made. But they have Victor Wembanyama. They have Trey Jones. They have Svi Mamukelashvili, which is the most difficult name for me to say, maybe in all of the NBA. I'm putting it up there. And then the Spurs Spanish radio play-by-play guy at the end looked at us and just goes, I've never seen half these guys before. And I'm like, yes, yes, we understand. That is the same situation. There was a player warming up yesterday for Memphis. And I was like, who is this white basketball player not named Luke Kennard or Jake LaRavia or John Conjar on the court? And it was the Grizzlies' newest 10-day signee, Jack White.
We
all know Jack White. Do you know where Jack White played basketball?
Whitesville.
Duke. Close enough.
Yep, synonymous. Jacob, get on the at the end of the season, we're going to do the whole
all 33?
All 33. All 33 of the players.
Because yeah. When Jack White took the court last night, it was the 33rd player to play for the Grizzlies this season. They used their 50th different starting lineup last year, and that is the record set because with 50 different starting lineups this season, the Memphis Grizzlies have now used more starting lineups than any NBA team ever since we began tracking starting lineup data in the 80s. 50! 50! Anthony Edwards is out here celebrating a 51-point game for the Minnesota Timberwolves last night, and we in Memphis are watching a 50th starting lineup. And Brandon Clark was the starting center. And there were some nice moments of him against Victor Wembanyama. Hell, even Trey Jemison had a great block on Victor Wembanyama on one end and then finished on the other, and you're like, yes, Trey Jemison, Wemby stopper. Then you're like, no. He is not. And that's okay. It is incredible to watch Victor Wembanyama in the flesh. This is the second time that he's played here. And there was an ESPN article that dropped on Victor Wembanyama right before the game last night that was really interesting. I highly suggest giving it a read. And it goes through the entirety of his rookie season and all of his accomplishments, all of the nature of not being able to play as much as he would have liked at times. And the last Spurs game here in Memphis, which was back in January, a lifetime ago, Victor Wembanyama got dunked on by Ja Morant in that game, but they pulled Wembanyama out late and he like begged to go back in. He checked himself back into the game and then Pop took him out yet again, even though Victor Wembanyama thought that the Spurs had an opportunity to win that game. And really the article just shows this picture of this guy who hates losing. He hates being on a 19, now 20 win Spurs team after their win over the Grizzlies last night. But God, that's going to be just nightmare fuel for everybody else because Spurs are going to be good really fast.
They'll probably do this again next season, just looking ahead some.
No.
They'll have to because of the Olympics, right? That's a part of this. He went straight from whatever league he was in, straight to FIBA, or sat out FIBA, then did Summer League, then did the NBA season, then he'll do the Olympics. I would imagine they'll do 2 years of this, and then in that third year, they'll unleash him. And just like, here you go. You rested your first summer since being a professional NBA player. Been a professional over there since being a professional NBA player. First summer with rest to let your body heal and adjust.
Yeah.
They'll come back that third year and just turn them loose on the league. Turn this loose. This was earlier in the week. I was trying to get this Monday for Oops, We Missed It. It was this weekend. Look at the reaction to the Sixers by the Sixers bench to Wembanyama doing this. Shot fake, one dribble, step back, corner three, wet. Look at the reaction to everybody on the bench. Look at all the side eyes they're giving them. They are slack-jawed, every single one of them. Look at the assistant coach. Just hands up, like, what are we doing? Why are we making people like this? If there was not NBA to be played, if there was no basketball league, if we just didn't have basketball as a sport, what the bleep would that be? Like, what would be the need for that type of person to be walking around these streets? There would be none. The NBA has made mutants. Like, we are witnessing, and we have been witnessing, mutants. And the mutants keep evolving because this game keeps changing and keeps evolving to the point to where now we've got that lurking about on the street. A 7'4" dude with a 10-foot wingspan hitting step-back threes. Are you kidding me?
So, I give you that clip, and let me raise you my favorite Victor Wembanyama highlight from the Grizzlies game last night. And it's not even him doing anything but existing, as the Grizzlies had a 3-on-1 break against Victor Wembanyama. Here's Brandon Clark thinking about, what are we going to do? Jemison, Brandon Clark, back to Jemison. Nope. Oh, we're just going to kick it out because Victor Wembanyama's there, and there is no way we are attacking the paint with the 7'4 alien standing in the middle.
Jemison's just,
what do you do?
Jemison's got to just throw that to the corner immediately.
Hot potato.
Brandon Clark gives it to you to give to the corner.
And then
you get the open shot. What are you supposed to do?
It was funny. I was sitting next to Bennett Doyle up on Radio Row, and he was doing the pre-rind with Kelsey on Instagram last night before the game. And we were predicting, like, just like the most outrageous thing that could possibly happen in the game. And Bennett's prediction was a Scottie Pippen Jr. to Brandon Clark alley-oop finish over Victor Wembanyama. So that would have been quite fun and audacious of it all. Mine was that Jack White would score in double figures. He had 6. Good try. Good effort. We were right in there. But then one of the other ones was that Mal Pereira would dunk on Victor Wembanyama. Mal Pereira is no longer with the Memphis Grizzlies. You got to keep up, people. You got to keep up with the 10-day contracts. He's out. Jack White's in. Xavier Simpson has another 10-day. We still haven't seen the magic of the Xavier Simpson hook shot. Maybe in these last 3 games we'll see one. Yeah, or the one step. We'll see one of those go. But the defense of Victor Wembanyama and Gigi Jackson had such an – I always hate using the word adorable because Gigi Jackson is 19 years old, and like you get to a point.
Grown ass man.
Please. He has some adorable answers. Like, let's strip the word adorable of like the
infantilism.
Yes.
Infantilism.
Thank you.
I don't know if that's a word, but sure.
A word all women should know quite well. But with Gigi Jackson talking about Victor Wembanyama, he was just like, he's going to be one of the best defensive players ever. One day, and you just coming straight off the court of having to deal with someone like Victor Wembanyama. And I was watching the TNT rap show last night because after I got home from Grizzly Spurs, I got to grace my eyeballs with Draymond Green making 5 threes for the Golden State Warriors, and the Warriors having the best 3-point shooting percentage of all time in their win against the Lakers. But they were talking about the Wemby versus Rudy Gobert Defensive Player of the Year debate, and Wemby has more blocks. He's averaging more steals, more deflections. The only difference is that Rudy Gobert anchors the number one defense in the NBA, and Victor Wembanyama is in a bottom 10 defense in the NBA. And that's a big defense. That's a big defense. That's a big difference. And it will likely lead to Rudy Gobert being your defensive player of the year. But yeah, Victor Wembanyama wants to win now. They got the win last night. It was their 20th of the season. The Grizzlies get the loss last night. Taylor Jenkins before the game did basically all but stamp that Jaren Jackson Jr. and Desmond Bain are done for the season. He said it's a good chance they are done for the season. We now haven't seen them in, 3-4 games. Desmond longer than Jaren at this point. But we will see these end-of-the-bench guys the rest of the way. Brandon Clark was good last night. He continues to be solid. His floater, it is so smooth at this point. And I saw a lot of chatter, because that's all we can do at this point as we are muddling our way through these final games. Like, could Brandon Clark be your starting center after all? Could Brandon Clark and Jaren Jackson Jr. be your starting front court duo next season? TBD. I mean, I think at the end of the day, you're going to see a lot of minutes with Jaren and Brandon Clark on the court together, and the defensive versatility that that duo gives, and allowing Jaren to operate more in that free safety role and off the ball, and what happens to Brandon Clark. Already being this far in his post-Achilles recovery journey is probably one of the biggest positive takeaways. We're always searching for positive takeaways here. But anyway, we're going to take a quick break. Before we do, it's the reason for the season. It is a Grizzlies game day. Let's fire up the tankathon. Let's see the draft simulation of the day. If the Grizzlies were to have the draft lottery today, what pick would they get? Other Jacob, press the button. It's gonna be a good day. 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 Gonna be a good day. Number one pick. Package that puppy up. Send it away. Bring something back. Anyway, that is your Grizzlies Spurs recap of the morning. We will go around the NBA. It was a busy night. They did get updates on Giannis Antetokounmpo. He had a scary looking injury last night. On the plus side, does not appear to be the big bad A word. We'll get into that along with some other stories from the basketball world when we come back.
Let's face it. There's a lot of trash talk in basketball. But the great teams let their performance do the talking. Like Ford F-150 with Pro Power Onboard, a class-exclusive industry-first feature that turns your truck into a mobile generator and leaves the competition speechless. Ford F-150, official truck of the Grizzlies. Greatness starts here at your Mid-South Ford dealer. Class is full-size pickups under 8,500 pounds, GBWR.
Grizzlies fans know it's the team that gives you the edge. Big River Steel does too. That's why we're recruiting the best talent to help us develop the sustainable steel needed for today and tomorrow. Join us at the edge of the future. Visit www.bigriversteel.com/join to join our Dash team. That's www.bigriversteel.com/join to join our Dash team.
We know there's only one team you want to watch. And Bally Sports is the place to get your Grizzlies. Experience the comebacks, the buzzer beaters, the can't-miss Memphis-made moments live. Bally Sports keeps the grind going before and after the game, too, with Pete, Brevin, Fish, and Chris on Grizzlies Live. Watch Grizzlies basketball all season long with Bally Sports and streaming on the Bally Sports app. Bally Sports, home of the only team you want to watch.
It's more fun to be there live to see the Memphis Grizzlies hit the court all season long. From the electricity in FedEx Forum to the highlight reel plays, there's nothing quite like Grizzlies basketball. As the official marketplace of the Memphis Grizzlies, Ticketmaster gets you in with a huge selection of seats. So get off the couch and into the stands while you still can. Score tickets today at Ticketmaster.com. That's Ticketmaster.com.
When it's all on the line, you turn to the strong, the stable, the unwavering, to those with a history of raising their performance to meet the moment. It's true in basketball. It's true in banking. Grizzlies checking from Pinnacle. Play hard, bank easy. Open a Grizzlies checking account with at least $100 and a recurring direct deposit by April 30th, and you could receive a $200 direct deposit bonus into your account. Details at grizzliesbanking.com. Member FDIC.
Did you do anything in that St. Joe's game?
No, I was strictly playing defense. Delonte West was tough. That's a pro. Oh, my God. That step back.
Oh, wait. Hold on. 40 minutes. You didn't even get a rest.
No, I played the whole game. 40.
6 for 11 from the field.
That was me.
12 points, 6 rebounds, 5 assists.
Oh, I was nice that game. I thought I ain't getting double figures.
The Chris Vernon Show, presented by Caesars Sportsbook. Live weekdays at noon on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Welcome back. Around the NBA last night, the Bucks beat the Celtics in a bizarre game where the Celtics took zero free throws. That was not the story of the game, although that was a bizarre anecdote. The big bad A word that the chat is full of a bunch of sickos trying to guess what that word means. Excuse me? I was just watching Grizzlies Spurs when all hell broke loose on Twitter with the news of Giannis Antetokounmpo going down with a non-contact lower leg injury and watching the video. CJ, I always forget. Have you seen Mean Girls?
Yeah, I've seen it.
Okay, so you know how Karen is able to tell when it's raining with her chest?
Oh, yeah, yeah,
and
yeah.
And she's
yeah,
like,
yeah,
there's a 35% chance that it's already raining.
Karen is the racially ambiguous one?
No, Karen is the blonde, ditzy one.
Okay, yeah. That.
Kind of dumb.
Got you.
I'm a mouse, duh.
Yeah.
So, like Karen knowing when it's going to rain, like, I have these, like, Achilles tingles. Like, when there's an injury in the sports world.
Where do your tingles
all
pop
of a sudden,
off
I get this, like, little back of the ankle tingly-dingly, and I'm like, ooh. I think someone just tore their Achilles. But just like Karen, I have a 35% chance that I'm wrong. And I was wrong last night, which is good. Because when Giannis Antetokounmpo goes down and is grabbing his lower leg, and I guess it was a little bit higher than the Achilles. What, was my math wrong?
No, Jessica, no. It's just, we can say phrases like tingly-dingly when talking about tingles emanating from the breast region in a movie that emanate from your Achilles, mm-hmm. But we can't let me be great and talk about my fashion.
No.
Okay.
We cannot. Ahead. Thank you. Thank you for clarifying.
You that's all
thank
we
for,
were talking about.
Thank you
over
for
here
clarifying in the you world. You and other Jacob continue wishing and hoping that I will let you do your final story of the day.
I'm tweeting it.
I won't.
It. I'm tweeting
fine
it.
Fine, tweet
at,
it.
At
that's
Con Radicalness on
that's
Twitter.
That's on your brand.
At Con Radicalness on Twitter.
Your brand.
I'm going to tweet this because okay it's some good stuff.
Great. Congratulations on your success. Anyway, the news this morning confirming that Giannis Antetokounmpo did not tear his Achilles last night in the Bucks game against the Celtics. The Achilles tendon is fully intact, and his return to play will come with how quickly his left calf strain heals. And calf strains are tricky. Calves are tricky. It's all connected in the bottom of your leg, and so now it will be a matter of determining the length of time that he has to sit out. The playoffs begin in like a week, and for the Milwaukee Bucks right now, who are the 2 seed in the East if the playoffs started today, but the Knicks are just 1 game behind them. The Magic are just 2 games behind them. The Cavs 2 games behind them, so congratulations to the Grizzlies who have to go play a Cleveland team that is very much trying to win here in the final week of the regular season. But when you look at who the Bucks could potentially be having to face coming out of the play-in tournament, could it be the Philadelphia 76ers? If they're without Giannis, the Sixers have Joel Embiid back. It could be big, bad badness for the Bucks. You hate to see it for Giannis. Your brain immediately goes back to Kevin Durant in 2019, who had a calf strain, and he fought to come back. And what happened? He tore the big bad A word.
He came back, and it was like, yo, you shouldn't come back. That was the finals game, right? Where he tore his Achilles, where it finally gave out on him. Like, yo, I get it, it's the finals. So if that's what you want to do, go out there and do it. I would think that the Bucks and Giannis would be a bit more careful with him. This isn't an NBA finals that he's potentially going to miss. They seem optimistic about him being able to come back soon enough. It's unfortunately for Dame. Like, yo, you got to go out there and carry this team through potentially a first round matchup against a team and coming out of the play-in game that's going to be good enough to beat you.
Yeah. Doc Rivers, who has already been going through it the last couple of weeks.
Saw a clip of Doc Rivers throwing the bus driver under the bus. He said everybody needs to be more professional.
Even the bus driver.
Even the bus driver. Like, my man, Doc, does not care who you are.
I am in misery.
He will throw you under the bus with the quickness.
No dodging the tires.
No.
Just straight. All right, also around the NBA last night, Clippers beat the Suns 105-92, but that game was wild because at one point it was 64-27, and before that it was 31-4. And during that early period where the Suns were in an eclipse of their own against the Clippers, somebody chose to propose at that game, and we talked often about just bad etiquette in sporting event proposals, and I think perhaps the worst would be wearing a Devin Booker jersey. So you are clearly a Phoenix Suns fan. Your team is down 23-4, but the kiss cam waits for no one, and making the decision to propose while your team is in that kind of a predicament. 10 out of 10 would not recommend. Wishing you all a happy and healthy marriage as you start on such an upswing. The other big play of the night in the NBA, and by big play of the night, I mean perhaps the worst play that you will ever witness in an NBA game. It's got to be up there as one of the worst of all time. It came in the Bulls-Knicks game, and you had Torrey Craig, who was all clear for a breakaway dunk. What does he do? Oh, no. Oh, Torrey Craig and Andre Drummond go up together and come down with just sheer awfulness.
When we ask the question, like, why would Billy Donovan leave the NBA to go to Kentucky? That is that
one.
Is that. You can just throw that on loop again.
That one.
What the hell is Drummond thinking? What the hell is Craig thinking?
No, what's Craig?
What's Craig
Craig's
thinking?
Trying to throw it off himself.
What's Craig thinking? Down nine.
Yes.
Down nine.
Yes.
Down nine.
You're Torrey Craig.
What are you, and then what is Drummond doing? It's very clear he's trying to catch the oop.
It's very
clear
jumping
through?
Thought that Torrey Craig was throwing it off the backboard for him trailing behind. Not, certainly Torrey Craig wouldn't have the audacity. Torrey Craig would not have the audacity to throw himself the dunk off the backboard.
Why, you see him jump first. So you just jump out of the way. You're in the back. You jump the F out the way. You see him leap
this alone,
first.
I'm not gonna lie, this alone made me question the basketball IQ. I know Andre Drummond has continuously been a name that's
pretty
I'm sorry.
Can't like, have him here
I'm
now.
These are things I can't forget. These are the intangibles that we talk about, the things that don't come up in the stat sheet.
You don't want that in your locker room. You don't want either of those in your locker
room. Can you imagine John Morant trying to complete the ultimate off the backboard sick dunk and someone just ruins it right behind? I mean, there's a big leap from Torrey Craig to John Morant or other stars. Who do we give a pass to doing the off the backboard dunks to themselves in the midst of games? Anthony Edwards.
Nobody.
There are some.
No, you should in the middle of a game. That's what.
If you're up 20.
That's disrespectful.
Yeah.
The risk reward and the respect factor. Nobody should be doing that in a regular game. It just shouldn't happen. Just because Anthony Edwards hit his, a couple other players have done it and made theirs as well. That doesn't mean like, oh, this is something that we should be encouraging folks to do. Certainly not down nine to a team that's lottery bound. Where are the Bulls at? Are they not in the lottery? Like, come on, man. No,
they're in the play-in.
Show a bit more professional, the East. Show a bit more professionalism than
that. Yeah,
come on.
The East. The Chicago Bulls at 37-42. Nice and comfy in the Eastern Conference play-in tournament. Meanwhile, like 3.5 games separate 3 through 10 in the West, or 5 through 10, I think is the actual stat there. It is fun. It makes for a really fun end of the NBA regular season, and all these guys have to play, and that's how you end up with a situation like Giannis Antetokounmpo getting hurt last night, and hopefully, knock on wood, fingers crossed, no more injuries and no more botched dunks like that. And when you find out that Billy Donovan is the new head coach at the University of Kentucky, just remember that play will be directly attributed to the reason why, allegedly, reportedly. All right, other big news from the basketball universe last night. Some very surprising news. The winningest coach in college basketball history, Tara Vanderveer, very surprising.
We would consider it quite surprising. I feel like reports were coming out that like this would be her last tournament at the start of the tournament.
The thought was when she passed Gino as winningest coach. Or no, she didn't pass Gino. Who did she pass? Coach K, yeah. When she passed Coach K as winningest coach in college basketball history, some of the conversation popped off, like, will she hold this forever? Gino is within striking distance, so who coaches the longest will probably be the one who ends up being in that top spot for a significant period of time. But I don't think it was considered possible that this was the end, especially given how Stanford goes out. They were a one seed, they get upset. Cameron Brink is going to the WNBA, but she's been at Stanford for 38 years. And all of the Bay Area reporters that I follow seemed genuinely surprised by the news last night and commented on her having a pretty good poker face because nobody really had any idea that this was coming, especially last night. But it's crazy when you look at it, 1,216 wins is her total tally there, a three-time NCAA champion, 15-time Pac-12 champion, 5-time National Coach of the Year. She started as an unpaid grad assistant. She went on to become the winningest head coach in NCAA history. When we talk about the fabric of women's basketball that was laid to allow for this season to be what it was, that allowed for a Caitlin Clark to have as monumental of a season and a growth in eyeballs on the women's game. Like, it's people like Tara Vanderveer who allowed the sport to become what it is today and to have it be healthy enough to be great. And she, one of her last press conferences was talking about just how great the Pac-12 was. And from one Pac-12 princess to another, she will be missed.
This feels like you watched Endgame, right? Mm-hmm. You watched Infinity War also, where Thanos, after the snap, just snaps himself to a restful planet and kind of sits down and looks out. It's like, now I can finally rest. Like, that's the type of work Vanderveer put in for this sport.
Now I don't have to do the ACC travel schedule.
Now I can rest, man. Now I can look around and look at the health of the game right now. Look at all of the stars in this game, players and coaches, and know it's in good hands. Know that I did my part to help elevate this to the point to where now it's, we'll talk about it here in a bit, is outdrawing the men's championship game, right? We've gotten to that point. It's changing a whole lot. I can rest. I helped get it here. I helped lay the foundation for the continued growth of women's basketball. Shout out to Coach Vanderveer and all that she accomplished. This game wouldn't be what it is today if not for people like her. So shout out to her.
Let's talk about it, CJ. What? Let's talk about it. The women's championship game. For the first time ever, outdrew the men's championship game. How many people watched South Carolina beat Iowa? That would be 18.9 million people. How many people watched UConn-Purdue? That would be 14.8 million. I am not great at math, but I am good enough to know that 18.9 million is significantly larger than 14.8 million. Almost 4 million more people watching. And I will say, because this isn't as much of a dunking on the men. I do that enough. This is more of a barometer. Like, the men have always had more eyeballs on the game. And so this is when you are talking about something significant, you have to have something to compare it to. And in this case, it is not pitting the women's and the men's tournament up against each other. It is simply showing that the standard is shifting. And there is competitive value in both. And people are hungry to watch women's basketball. Everyone's watching women's sports. Just ask Chris Paul, who wore a shirt that said that going into the Warriors game last night. I was like, when a person you hate makes a great point. And it's the truth, and that's where we're at.
Yeah, we don't. I know how this thing is going to play out on social media and how it's going to play out on sports talk shows. I wish it wouldn't. But this isn't, like you said, they're not in competition with one another. They can both exist and thrive. They can both thrive. And I think this shows that, mm-hmm. where they can both draw large numbers of people. I think it also shows we prefer Sunday at 2. We prefer Sunday at 2.
Speak on
to Monday at 8:20.
Speak on
You want to do Terry Crews starting at 8 o'clock and have him tell
daggum
longest, most boring-ass stories for like 5 minutes. No, we prefer that. But there was a time when, no matter what time these games are on, the men would always outdraw the women. There was a time when that would have been the case, but now we've shifted away from that time. Now it's time to start thinking about and experimenting some with different times so that it's not so late on a Monday. And it's time to continue investing in the women's game because they have skyrocketed this year in general interest. I don't understand people who say, yeah, I like basketball, but no, I won't watch X. I like basketball, but I can't watch the NBA. I like college. Yeah. Like, okay, you have your preference, but you should be able to watch college ball.
You don't have to watch everything. None of us watch everything.
You don't have to watch everything, but if it's on your TV, why wouldn't you stop and watch Eurobasket? Why wouldn't you stop and watch the Euros?
Listen,
why wouldn't you stop and watch
the
FIBAs?
I have the same thing about football. If you love football, why are you not watching UConn New Mexico State week one?
Because they're not good. Let me clarify. You're watching good ones.
I don't know.
You gotta watch the good ones. No.
Watch
good things. Watch good things. I'm not watching UConn, New Mexico State. Are you kidding? UMass Charlotte? You're a sicko.
Oh, Biff,
you need help.
Back with those
I'm gonna bring in a straight jacket and we're gonna carry you out of here and take you to Lakeside or some damn where so you can get the help that you need. My gosh. The good ones.
I'm sorry, are you trying to send me Are you saying I need mental health?
You're hysterical.
Are you calling me hysterical?
You're hysterical. Yes.
Are you? Yes. Are you the Arizona Supreme Court? Are you trying to go back to the
1800s? Damn right I am. I'm trying to put everybody, every person, man, woman, or child who wants to sit down and watch UTEP take on Idaho. Yes, all of you need to get help.
To be fair, if there was a reason for someone to recommend me getting a lobotomy, it would probably be connected to whatever week zero college football game I'm watching.
If you're excited to watch week zero Hawaii take on,
okay, we don't have to bring Hawaii into this.
Hawaii's playing HBCU. Delaware State. Hawaii, Delaware State, week zero. If you're excited about that matchup, you need help. There's got to be a number you can call.
Oh, it is Hawaii, Delaware State.
Jessica,
I didn't know that was. I thought you made that up.
HBCU Huddle.
These are. They'll let you know the week zero. How about Montana State at New Mexico?
Jessica.
How about SMU at Nevada? And then we get the Aer Lingus College Football Classic. Florida State, Aer Lingus.
That was
a
different lingus.
You know
I thought you were talking about a different lingus.
I flew Aer Lingus to Dublin, and we talked about it. They have shamrocks on the seats. It's a beautiful thing. Mike Norvell is thrilled. He took his family to Ireland a few weeks ago. I don't know what it was. I saw pictures on social media.
So you can talk about various linguses, but I can't talk about the wardrobe. I can't talk about the fit.
No. Can you give a quick shout out to the She Believes Cup? Because I know that's what you were watching as I was being tortured by Grizzlies Spurs.
Speaking of women's
in the
game.
Best of ways.
And listen, remotes work. So I'm primarily on the She Believes, and I'm flipping to the Spurs, and I'm flipping to the Bucks and the Celtics. So I'm flipping around. But the She Believes Cup is my jam. There's nothing but love for Alyssa Nair. A goalkeeper who made not one, not two, but three saves during penalties and scored a goal on her own penalties. Fifth straight She Believes Cup. And what I love about this team right now is the fact that they can be down and you think they can still fight their way back. Look at Smith. Smith is going to get this down 0-1 just outside the box. Give me that. Give me that right there for the equalizer. They go down to Canada again. They go down again. What does Sophia Smith do? Just big old ones. Just big old ovaries. Letting the ovaries dangle. Give me that rock. Down. Break straight down the middle. Pass it to her. Finish. One touch. What a finish right there. Knot it up. They go to PKs. And now it's all down to this. It's all down to this. One kick to win it all. One kick for the game. One kick to win the She Believes Cup for the fifth time. And boom. Right there. USA, USA, US, mother bleeping A, baby.
USA,
let's go.
USA.
Shout out to Fox. Shout out to Alyssa Nair. There was a scare with Swanson, so they ended up pulling her out a bit. But Swanson, since she's been back, looks like Swanson of old. I look forward to seeing what this team does in the Olympics. Their coach, why am I blanking on coach's name? This is the last game for the interim coach. The new coach is coming over. This week, I do believe she's coaching over in Europe right now.
The interim is Twyla Kilgore.
I think the new coach is coaching over in Chelsea right now, coaching the women over there, coming over at the end of the season, and this thing should keep rolling. Now, they won the CONCACAF. They won the Gold Cup.
Yes.
They won the She Believes Cup.
Yes.
They didn't place in the world, so they didn't place.
Okay.
Now it's time to go to the Olympics. They had a disappointing showing in the Olympics as well. Let's see what they do.
Didn't
in this
the men
year's
recently
Olympics.
Beat Mexico?
Who cares?
No, I'm saying, I mean, if we can have complete soccer domination.
We can't.
I care. They're both going to the Olympics. Yeah. Thank you, other Jacob.
Okay, whatever. The men are going to disappoint me. I've done this way too
many
times.
CJ, men matter too. Okay.
No, they don't.
Contrary to the matriarchy that we live in.
Not the U.S. Men's soccer team. No, they don't. No, they don't.
They're trying.
Try harder. Be better.
They qualified.
They qualified. This is America, Jessica. Since when do we care about qualifying? Can you please get out of the group stage? Can you please get out of the round of 16? Can we please get a medal? Can we please get to a medal game? No, the men can't do that. What?
I forgot to say something important before we get to D'Angelo Williams.
Okay.
I have to give an apology on today's. It's really serious.
Okay.
So if you can be serious. Yesterday, we talked about brackets on the show, and we discussed the people who won the Rise and Grind / Jessica Benson Show with CJ Hurt chat brackets, and congratulations to them. But I received a phone call later that afternoon of someone whose feelings were very hurt that I didn't praise her brackets
Whose
on the
bracket?
Show. And that would be my mother.
Oh, shout out!
Sharon Ryan hyphen Benson, the great SRB, who won both the men's and the women's brackets. And don't ask how many people she was competing against, too. But she had a 97 percentile men's bracket. She had UConn to win. And she had a 94 percentile women's bracket. She had South Carolina to win. So she said, of all the times that I mention her name that make her cringe, she was hopeful that I would do one that made her proud. Nice. So this one's to you, Mom, and you're absolutely cringing that I did it anyway.
Nice.
Heart hands. All right, we got to take a quick break when we come back. D'Angelo Williams will join us. He went to Disneyland Paris last week, and I hope he will talk to us about that. Who knows what else he wants to bring up? We'll find out on the other side. Take your fandom to the next level with the official Grizzlies app. Go all access and behind the scenes.
It's got to be heavy defense. That's where it starts for us.
Personalized to where you are and who you are. Get easy access to ticketing, the game day guide, and your own app customization right at your fingertips. Upgrade your experience and download the Grizzlies app today. LifeCare Ambulance is proud to be an official partner of the Memphis Grizzlies and FedEx Forum. At LifeCare, they wear their hearts with pride. Their passion is their people. They want you to love what you do and where you do it. Their employee-driven culture encourages a healthy work-life balance and supportive work environment. They invest in your success and well-being so that you can provide the best care for the patients that they serve. Join the incredible team of EMTs and paramedics in Memphis, Nashville, and across the nation today. Learn more at LifeCareAMB.com.
Sauced by Will Smith is taking the championship taste to FedEx Forum. Come enjoy your favorite lineup of sauces on traditional and boneless wings the next time you see the Memphis Grizzlies play. All of your favorite sauces, including the famous Garlic sauce, are now available as you cheer the home team on. Visit Sauced by Will Smith inside FedEx Forum at your next Grizzlies game, or come visit us anytime at our location in South Haven, Mississippi. Championship sauce, championship taste. Come get sauced today.
Now for a limited time, the new $1.99 crispy tender wraps are here at Sonic. Who could deny a crispy chicken tender with bold flavors like hickory barbecue and cheesy Baja? And we can't forget the crisp lettuce and melty cheese to make the perfect bite. Wrap yourself up with some TLC, tender, love, and chicken for only $1.99. Sonic $1.99 crispy tender wraps. Tax not included, limited time only at participating Sonic drive-ins.
Students, get back to the grind and cheer on your Memphis Grizzlies at FedEx Forum. Don't miss out on our exclusive student ticket program presented by Big River Steel. Get affordable tickets for all the major showdowns, including matchups against the Lakers, 76ers, Nuggets, and more. Sign up today to get alerts about this exclusive ticket deal at grizzlies.com/students.
Did I invent this? Low-key?
Did you?
I spent years calling my ex-producer Cowboy Carson, and now Beyonce, she decides she wants to dabble in country, in the genre. Now she's calling her album Cowboy Carter.
When she's doing her next concert, that's and right. She says, hey, my new album's about to come out, Cowboy Carter.
Inspired by the Gary Parrish Show.
Shout out GP in Memphis.
The Gary Parrish Show, live weekdays at 10 a.m. on YouTube at Grind City Media and the official Grind City Media app.
Maxwell in concert. The Serenade Tour, October 16th at FedEx Forum. Maxwell, with special guest Jasmine Sullivan, and October London. Tickets on sale now at LiveNation.com. You don't miss Maxwell Live.
Welcome back. It is Wednesday. That means it is time to check in with D'Angelo Williams. Bonjour, D'Angelo.
Oui,
oui.
I don't.
Oh, no. We cannot hear you. That's Italian.
D'Angelo, this is not going to work, dog.
Je n'écoute pas.
Why are you like That's, we got to,
I can't hear him.
We've got to get him figured out.
That's tough. I like his lime green hoodie.
Yeah, now I like five. Now his he's hand. Frozen. D'Angelo, hop off. Okay. He's hanging up. He's going to try and recall back.
Straight bars. Now, that's what I'm assuming. Back. Okay.
That's what I'm assuming.
Okay. He went to Pearly. He come back.
While we wait on him.
Sure.
We didn't get to it.
Week one of the college football season next year. Yes, you're correct. Clemson, Georgia at Mercedes-Benz Stadium. I have the schedule right here.
Yeah, week one. You should be watching. We should watch Clemson,
Miami,
Georgia.
Miami, Florida.
We should
Notre
watch
Notre Dame,
that.
Texas A&M.
We should watch that.
Penn State, West Virginia.
Yeah, watch that one also. That's going to be a great
North
rivalry
Dakota
game.
North Dakota State, Colorado.
Stop it. Stop
run,
it.
Ralphie, run.
Stop it.
Prime time.
Stop it.
Can Coach Prime convince everyone to watch Colorado, North
yes!
Dakota State week one?
Yes.
How about South Dakota State, Oklahoma State?
No. D'Angelo, thank God she's back. D'Angelo. All right.
Hey, what's going
on? What'd you say?
I said hello, everybody.
Oh, now, bonjour.
Thank goodness.
Why are you doing that?
Because you went to Patty.
She's a weirdo.
Look, that was I'm back. You should be saying something like.
All right, hold on, D'Angelo. Like what the hell is going on here?
Cannot understand what word you're saying. Just like you're in a foreign country, I cannot understand.
Wait, are
word
you still
saying.
In a foreign country?
No, he's home.
No, I'm not.
Are you home?
I am.
Are you going to change another tire? Like, what are you doing?
I'm not doing it. Wow. What did that come?
Because you're in the car and your reception is terrible. Even when you went to change the tire, your reception was fine. It was good. We could use it.
That's true.
We should be good now. I'm on Wi-Fi.
Okay, I hear you now. As Nick said in the chat, D'Angelo, you go to Paris, you become Wee Angelo Williams.
Nobody
it's pretty
her.
Good.
So much, Jessica.
It's pretty good.
So much.
How are you? What's new? We can hear you now. That's great.
We've had one of the sports. I want to talk to Steve.
Well, if you want to talk
you
to
can't
CJ,
talk to
unfortunately,
me your reception
we can barely.
Is terrible. Cop off of Wi-Fi. Just turn your Wi-Fi. Don't hang up. Just turn
no,
your Wi-Fi
walk.
Off.
Oh, we're going on a walk. We're going on a journey.
He doesn't want to show us the house, Jacob.
He never
that's
wants
what
to
he
show
should
us his
do.
Because
we do the door counter. He knows the door
all
counter.
We ever,
is
all we
coming.
Ever want. All
look
we ever want is a Cribs episode.
The camera. Yeah, here we go.
There we go.
There it is.
Okay.
Are we better now?
We're much better
yes.
now. Okay. So what I was saying.
No, we're not. God.
Is it windy where you are, D'Angelo? Oh, that's one.
Oh, he has a nice read.
That's one.
Okay, he's inside. You're like glowing. You must have great windows.
He does.
Very expensive windows.
He's trying not to walk through another door. Oh, boo.
Being on the couch.
All right, go ahead, D.
I said it's been a week here in sports. The reason
why. Turn your Wi-Fi off.
We can't hear you.
Just turn it off.
You're like first three words will come through, and then you're just not.
Yeah, turn the Wi-Fi off, and then give us the camera back. And Jessica, keep reading through some of your highlights from week one college football.
Oh, don't mind if I do. Well, I was going to say, we also found out that we are getting an NFL Friday game. It's going to be played in Brazil. And it's the first time the NFL, as we've discussed, first they stole Christmas, then they'll steal every other game of the week.
Oh, wait a second.
But it's going to be Packers-Eagles.
In Brazil?
In Brazil. For the first time in more than 50 years, an NFL game will be played on Friday night of opening weekend. So it's straight off the gate.
Cool. I like it.
Yay.
I like it.
This is going well.
Well, keep reading off week
okay.
one matchups.
More
or
week
we can
one.
Talk about
oh,
the Predators.
Vegas,
here comes
Vegas
D'Angelo.
Kickoff classic between LSU and USC.
Okay.
Here we go, D. You're good. All right. What are we talking about, D? You wanted to ask me something.
Okay. I said, so it's been a weird year in sports. Do you
sure.
agree?
Yes.
It's been a weird year in sports. Well, somehow, I know how we got there, but we've been talking about Caitlin Clark. How okay. special she is and how dominant she is in her sport.
Okay.
Well, while we were on this trip out of the country, it was somebody that said that she was the greatest player to ever play basketball. And I go, I go, you mean like overall, or you mean like in like her sport? And they go, in any sport. And I go, well, there's a difference, because the level of competition is a little bit different from the level of competition in that sport.
Be careful.
I know. I'm trying to, because
D'Angelo, wait, hold up. You don't got to be careful. It's not March no more. We don't care about these women. Light into them.
So with saying that, the question came up: if you were starting an NBA team, are you taking Caitlin Clark or are you taking Bronny James?
Taking who?
LeBron James.
First off, you can't get back. No, don't. You can't compare Bronny James to Caitlin Clark. That's not a comparison
that
you can make.
That's not how this works.
That's not how it works at all. Whoever said that Caitlin Clark is the greatest basketball player ever, they're wrong. They're wrong not because Caitlin Clark is a woman and there's a difference in men's game and women's game. Because
she's like 21 years old.
Her career's not over. Caitlin Clark's not the greatest woman to ever play basketball, right? Like, we don't have to...
She could... Let's be clear, though. She could be
fine.
Someday.
Fine, sure.
She just put together one of the... D'Angelo, we do that. I have to sit up because my back hurts because
like
I'm old.
You can't... We can't continue to do this with these people,
yes,
right?
I'm so sick of this.
These conversations benefit anybody at all. We can talk about the legacy things when legacies are done, not while they're being built.
Can't we just enjoy greatness as we watch it and say this is one of the greatest performances, this is one of the greatest athletes that I've watched in her sport, in sports period. Like, take it outside of basketball even. What she has done for sports period has been incredible. She has eclipsed just being sports coverage and has been like a national news story, right? When CJ and I were talking about this the other week, like, when does sports become pop culture? And the women's basketball tournament became a cultural event. And it's not just because of Caitlin Clark, because that really grinds my gears too. Because even after South Carolina completes a perfect season, Dawn Staley wins her third title as head coach of the South Carolina Gamecocks, all of the coverage is on Caitlin Clark, and that's wrong as well. But when it comes to just like appreciating great things as we see it, we love to create this like vacuum of, we have to be able to determine if someone would be on my Mount Rushmore today, instead of adding to the mounts of the Rushmore. What do you think? It's okay. It's fine. We can go back and forth.
It's okay. They drew parallels between the sport. They drew parallels. I only brought it up for this reason and this reason alone. Caitlin Clark is probably the female Steph Curry. And just let me finish. She's regarded as one of the best players to ever play the sport overall. But when Steph does it, he's only considered the greatest shooter.
Yeah.
It makes no sense to me.
What do you mean?
Like, if she can shoot, if she's doing the same thing he's doing, and she's regarded the best overall, like man or woman, and he's been doing this forever, and he's only regarded as the greatest shooter, I'm just trying to see, like, where in this scale, like, why are we, what are we doing here?
I don't know who's regarding her as best of overall or best ever, right? I'm not sure where this is. You and I talking, D. This is us talking. Right. Safe space, right? I'm not sure. Oh. I'd have to sit down and really think about it. I'm not sure. Past decade, I'm not sure where I would pick Caitlin Clark. I'm not sure if I would have her. Certainly, I think I'd have her top 10.
Oh, you would have. In the past decade, she's top 5.
Is she?
She's the...
Where's Stewie?
She's the all-time...
Has Stewie been 10
years? Okay,
well,
then we get into the conversation.
Sabrina, Stewie.
Do championships affect somebody's...
Plum? Like, I think I'd have her ahead of Plum. I think. I'm not really certain. Is Maya Moore in the past 10 years?
She's 20 years.
Okay. All right. So,
no.
What am I doing with Arike Ogunwale, right? Like... she's been the past 10 years. What am I doing with somebody like that.
Really don't think we have to. Maya Moore is just outside the last decade.
Okay.
Maya Moore is you could make a case for Maya Moore being the best women's basketball player of all time. But the thing with Caitlin Clark, we don't have to do this with Caitlin Clark because you don't have to diminish what Caitlin Clark has done this season. Like, she is one of the greatest college basketball players we have ever seen. I don't feel this burning desire to sit here and try to be like, well, she is absolutely the greatest, or she is not the greatest because of X, Y, and Z. Like, we saw what we saw, and not only is she a great shooter, because I do understand that side of it, D'Angelo, because we do that with Steph. And sometimes that's unfair to Steph Curry because there are so many other elements to his game that get underrated, but the biggest thing he is greatest shooter of all time. With Caitlin Clark, she's a great shooter. She pulls it from the logo. She's able to get to her spots. She has the confidence. She has the stroke, everything. She's also an amazing passer, like a criminally underrated passer. And when people are just casually joining the women's basketball conversation, it's like, oh, Caitlin Clark the shooter. But like, there's a totality to her game that allowed her. If Caitlin Clark just shoots, Iowa's not a one seed. Iowa's not playing in back-to-back national championship games.
My point with that, the where I'd have her the past decade, is challenging somebody who says, hey, she's the best ever. You
sure.
know what I'm saying?
Because
I think that, and you've talked about this a time or two, in talking about Caitlin Clark, and this is just sports talk, this is what we do. And talking about her and her greatness, because make no doubt about it, she is great. You end up kind of downplaying others who came about who were also great. Right?
And others who played in a time where
we
were not
watching,
shining
we weren't
this
shining
aggressive
lights on them.
Beam of light. I mean, Candace Parker was great.
Shamika.
Cheryl Miller was great.
Oh,
Lisa Leslie was great. Cheryl Swoops was great. Like, we can go on and on.
You just started naming
on.
A whole bunch of USC people.
I know. It's
yeah.
so fun. Like, my favorite.
Yeah, you're fandom. You're fandom.
Nice.
But like that, that's the thing I don't understand about the conversation you and the people were having. Like, why would you, when there are other great people around playing basketball here recently, why you would feel so emboldened to make the statement that Caitlin Clark is the greatest basketball player ever? And we hadn't even gotten to the 2000s, to the aughts, or to the 90s and the 80s where the Cheryl Millers were. We didn't talk about Nancy Lieberman in the 80s, right? We hadn't even gotten there yet. I think that in the excitement, because the light is on now, the light is on this sport because of Caitlin Clark, and in that excitement, it's like, oh, we would love to watch. We love watching great things. We're all watching Caitlin Clark. We didn't watch Nancy Lieberman, probably because Nancy Lieberman wasn't that great.
Right.
No, that's not the reason why we weren't watching women's sports. We weren't watching them for, you know, sexism.
They weren't being put on. They weren't being promoted. We weren't getting the stories. We weren't getting the constant attention. And again,
chicks can't play basketball. Like that's where we were once upon a time. And we ended up
get back in the kitchen. The women's product is significantly less than the men. They can't even dunk. They can't even dunk.
Jessica, get back in the kitchen. You went a little too far.
I'm sorry. Have you gone to a post even on the post about the women's game having more viewership than the men's?
Are we still doing get back in the kitchen?
Yes, absolutely.
We're still like
still get back in the kitchen.
Well, I mean, they,
at least once a week.
They've never eaten your food, Jessica. They should know.
I know. Should I send them something?
Yes.
Should I remind them I got a C in home ec?
Jessica.
Is that your only C
of all time?
Whoa.
Jessica, in their defense, you did tear your Achilles playing basketball.
It's true. But hold a candle.
Hold on, wait. Using that logic, if tearing your Achilles while playing basketball means you need to not play basketball and cook.
Kevin Durant, get
Clay
in the kitchen,
Thompson?
Baby.
Didn't Boone Cousins tear his?
Brandon Clark,
got to go back to the kitchen.
Your recent gains have been inspiring, but it's time.
That's the thing.
And it's time to learn recipes.
Since those pairs. They've been in the kitchen since those pairs because we hadn't heard anything from them. There's no All-Stars. There's no All-NBA.
Clay's got at least one championship since then, doesn't he?
Kevin Durant's got multiple All-Stars
Durant
since then.
Have a championship after 10
I said Klay
no,
Thompson.
I didn't say a championship.
I said Klay Thompson's got one.
You said All-Stars and All-NBAs.
I forgot about Klay. But Klay's a Sabrina.
Just for the record, KD has been an All-Star every year since returning from his Achilles injury.
Well, anybody can be an All-Star. Does he hey, have now, all you're NBA?
An all-star. When Smash Mouth said, hey, all now NBA, you're an all-star, they meant it.
All yep. NBA is what I probably should have.
All NBA. How many All NBAs does he have? Because he doesn't. If he only has one, he's gonna take his ass back to the kitchen.
First team or second team?
That doesn't matter.
He has one second. He has two second teams since Terrence goes.
I guess he's fine then. D'Angelo, would you agree he doesn't have to go to the kitchen? How many All NBAs do you have, Jessica, since tearing your Achilles?
I think zero.
Well, get back in the kitchen and make us sandwiches, then, woman.
I think sandwiches I can do.
I do make a means, especially grilled cheese. It's slightly burnt, but you'll get over it. You can just pick the burnt spots off.
Because we gotta be truthful.
Uh-huh.
How many points were you averaging before the Achilles tear versus what you was averaging after?
In my heyday, I was mostly a scorer because I wasn't particularly the fastest girl on the court. But in most recent history, I believe in the tournament that I tore my Achilles, I was averaging 2 points. So okay. I think I scored one basket. Before, but I was a little defensive menace, you know?
You were the role player, though, because y'all were in the semifinals?
Yeah. Oh, hell yeah.
Yeah, yeah. My team got bounced early. Mm-hmm. The game plan was to throw me the ball and have me go to work on the block.
I was Tony Elling it.
So I have a question. I have a question before I get off, and I've asked this question on our podcast, and you guys probably already know the answer to this, but I want to know, what is your worst NBA player that made the Hall of Fame?
Oof.
Worst NBA player to make the NBA.
Are you finna throw some more shade at Dennis Rodman? Because we're not doing this. We're not doing this.
Let me get this straight. Dennis Rodman is an all-time favorite of mine because I like this personality. I like the way, like, the weird people back in the days that showed their personality and that was different. Those are the guys that I like because they were different. Okay. So I have nothing against Rodman, but from a NBA perspective, from a basketball mindset, I think overall he was the worst basketball player to get it done to the Hall of Fame. Wow. It just makes sense to me. Like, I mean, if you averaging 4 points, regardless of what the other stats mean, the 4 points is what, like, hold presidents over everything. We're talking about...
You don't care about... So he's averaging 4 points and 25 rebounds.
Right,
and
that's
three
what I was
blocks.
Trying to see,
like,
what his final rebound
here?
Average is.
Like, Dennis Rodman got to be averaging, like, 16, 17 rebounds for his career.
Okay.
Actually, he averaged 7 points and 13 rebounds.
Like 13, averaging 13 averaging means that there were years, there were entire years where he averaged over 13 rebounds per game.
Okay. You got to give me another basketball player in the Hall of Fame that's worse.
Casey Jones is in the Hall of Fame. He averaged 8 points on 38%.
Bill Bradley averaged 12 points, 3 rebounds, 3 assists.
Like, come on now.
Well, averaged 16 points in a season once in his career.
That's significant. 12 points?
D'Angelo, why are you so infatuated with points?
And
do
why
you not
are
you care
so
about
infatuated
anything else?
With the worst? They made the Hall of Fame.
Because in order for you to win basketball games, it's a point system. It's who scores the most points, right? Right now, if you name all the top NBA players right now, you're naming them because of the offense that they create, which is points.
No.
Your top five right now probably lead the NBA in scoring.
No, because we take other things into consideration,
D'Angelo.
Yes, we do.
That's not what I'm
saying. Yes, we do.
That's
not what
right
saying.
Now.
Right now, we do also.
Your top five right now, all five of your top five will probably be scorers.
I don't know, D'Angelo. What? Why are you this way?
Okay, I'm willing to entertain your comment.
Oh, whatever.
Top five scorers in the NBA right now are Luka, Giannis, SGA, Jalen Brunson, and Kevin Durant. Kevin Durant, who should be back in the kitchen.
Well, Kevin Durant.
So
Brunson wouldn't be in my top five. Only one in my top
Brunson
five saying
be.
Again.
Luka and Giannis are in my top five. Okay, and then if you go out to the 10, sixth is Devin Booker, seventh is Jason Tatum, eighth is De'Aaron Fox, ninth is Nikola Jokic. There's another that would be in my top five. 10 is Steph Curry.
Well, think about why Jokic is there. Jokic isn't there, and Giannis isn't there just because they're scoring. Luka's not there just because they're scoring.
They're all there in their totality, but I'm saying that offense is primo in the NBA right now, and so both in scoring and assisting. That's fine. I'm not saying he's right.
Yeah, you are. You're on D'Angelo's side.
If you look at the greatest basketball players of all time, the thing that they have in common is they score. They possess the ball, and they put it in the hoop. Kobe Bryant, Michael Jordan. Every time we get into a conversation about who's the greatest, it always comes down to scoring. We don't talk about rebound.
We talk about all defensive selections. We talk about being able to block shots. We talk about being able to pitch your imprint on a game. Yes, we do. Because if we didn't, then the true worst person in the Hall of Fame, the true worst basketball player in the Hall of Fame will be talked about as one of the greatest basketball players ever, and that is Karl Malone. If all we cared about was points, we'd be like, oh, pick Karl Malone's old cheating, high-kicking ass in the conversation of all-time greats. And nobody even mentions Karl Malone as one of the all-time greats.
Look, when you talk about Dennis Rodman, when you talk about Draymond Green, you'll be talking about the things that they did either off the court or the things that they did when they was locked up.
Neither one of them has been locked up.
Locked up.
Draymond should be for assault and battery.
We're not over with yet. He already choked him out twice. It ain't over with yet.
That's a dirty thing to say about Draymond coming off a game where he happened to hit 5 threes.
You know what? You know what's dirtier?
What?
You said
kicking someone in the nuts, also fair.
You said that's a dirty thing to say about Draymond Green after coming off a game where he hit. I'm thinking, oh no, he hit another person again. Did he hit another person?
He did it again.
I forgot he was out from three.
D'Angelo, I have to let you go because I have to do a magic trick with CJ. But it's been a joy, as always. And I hope you had a great time in Disney Paris. And Paris
It was amazing. London was also amazing. I love France. That's all I'm gonna say.
What was the best ride?
The best ride was there's a Spider-Man ride where you get to throw webs, and I was throwing webs, and I like to think that I was the best in this family.
Okay.
And now that I've conquered being the best in my family, I'm not gonna conquer the world.
You go out and conquer, D'Angelo. We'll see you next week.
Thank you.
Bye. I do love Disneyland rides that are games that make you compete against your family. There was that Buzz Lightyear shooting game growing up. Oh.
Didn't ride that one. What was that? Is that Land or World?
I think it originated at Land and then moved its way to World, maybe, but that game was fire.
Have you seen the Princess and the Frog animatron?
Of course, yes.
So we'll show that. I saved that for tomorrow. Can I read you something real quick?
I'm nervous.
Dennis Rodman.
Oh, thank God.
1990 to 1998. Dennis Rodman's rebounding stats for the season. 1991, 12.5. Next year, 18.7. Average, 18.7 rebounds per game.
You don't 18.3, have to
17.3, 16.8, 14.9, 16, 15. Dennis Rodman should be averaging for his career closer to like 15 rebounds per game. But his rookie year, he averaged 4 rebounds per game because he was a rookie and the Pistons weren't really playing him a lot. Like, get out of here. Stop it. Stop it.
Can I cleanse the show? Every time D'Angelo Williams makes disparaging comments towards Dennis Rodman, I feel like we have to do a full show cleanse, like some sage, get Kyrie Irving in here. Yeah. We're going to take a break. We're going to come back. We have so many things, all the things. We have story time. The votes are in. With 35% of the vote, birthday dinner bill looks like it's going to be our story of the day. I also have a magic trick. I am so excited. It's a magic trick. Riddle, magic trick, whatever it may be. Look at this nice graphic. Vanna Whiting it. Other Jacob, popping that graphic right up there. And then we're going to talk about over-sexual cicadas with fungus. They're zombies.
And we're going to talk?
No. Get ready. I'm going to let you be great. You're going to get this magic trick. You're going to feel so cool. Just kidding. I'm going to feel so cool. All right. We'll do it when we get back on the other side.
Something you'll never do. I turn around and I level you. No motivation is needed. Look, I put my myself on the pedestal. This is incredible.
Take your fandom to the next level with the official Grizzlies app. Go all access and behind the scenes.
It's got to be heavy defense. That's where it starts for us.
Personalized to where you are and who you are. Get easy access to ticketing, the game day guide, and your own app customization right at your fingertips. Upgrade your experience and download the Grizzlies app today. LifeCare Ambulance is proud to be an official partner of the Memphis Grizzlies and FedEx Forum. At LifeCare, they wear their hearts with pride. Their passion is their people. They want you to love what you do and where you do it. Their employee-driven culture encourages a healthy work-life balance and supportive work environment. They invest in your success and well-being so that you can provide the best care for the patients that they serve. Join the incredible team of EMTs and paramedics in Memphis, Nashville, and across the nation today. Learn more at lifecareamb.com.
It's more fun to be there live to see the Memphis Grizzlies hit the court all season long. From the electricity in FedEx Forum to the highlight reel plays, there's nothing quite like Grizzlies basketball. As the official marketplace of the Memphis Grizzlies, Ticketmaster gets you in with a huge selection of seats. So get off the couch and into the stands while you still can. Score tickets today at Ticketmaster.com. That's Ticketmaster.com.
Sauced by Will Smith is taking their championship taste to FedEx Forum. Come enjoy your favorite lineup of sauces on traditional and boneless wings the next time you see the Memphis Grizzlies play. All of your favorite sauces, including the famous Garrick sauce, are now available as you cheer the home team on. Visit Sauced by Will Smith inside FedEx Forum at your next Grizzlies game, or come visit us anytime at our location in South Haven, Mississippi. Championship sauce, championship taste. Come get sauced today.
Students, get back to the grind and cheer on your Memphis Grizzlies at FedEx Forum. Don't miss out on our exclusive student ticket program presented by Big River Steel. Get affordable tickets for all the major showdowns, including matchups against the Lakers, 76ers, Nuggets, and more. Sign up today to get alerts about this exclusive ticket deal at grizzlies.com/students.
There was some sad news coming out of the WWE. Michael Jones, also known as Virgil, passed away. He's a Virginia Union alum, so he graduated from an HBCU. He got his start in Memphis, right?
Oh, man, you're absolutely right. He started in Memphis in 1985.
Get all of your HBCU sports and culture news by tuning in to HBCU Huddle with CJ Hurt and Mike Wallace. New episodes drop every Thursday on GrindCityMedia.com, YouTube, and Spotify.
Are you a healthcare professional looking for a new experience? Look no further than Travel Nurses, Inc. Our extensive network of healthcare facilities across the country offers you the opportunity to discover new destinations while pursuing your passion. We provide competitive compensation, flexible contracts, and dedicated assistance. So join our community of nurses and allied health professionals and start your next adventure today. Visit our website at TravelNursesInc.com for more information.
This is another JBS production.
Twinkle, twinkle, rock-a-bye. It's story time, let's let it fly. The JB Show with CJ here to bring you tales that bring you cheer or fear or tears, whatever it's here. Now hush you babies, listen up, it's story time, let's get turned up.
It's Wednesday. It's time for story time. Let's go. Am I the a-hole for taking advantage of my girlfriend? I feel like I'm about to get flamed.
Yes.
If that's how you start.
If that's how it starts, I the a-hole for taking advantage of my girlfriend? Okay, story's over. Yes. I feel like I'm about to get flamed, so throw away. Well, you know, my girlfriend and I have been together for 3 years. Since we started dating, we have a tradition of paying for each other for dinner for our birthdays. We don't have a limit on how much that meal would cost. My girlfriend doesn't drink. She at most has a mocktail or a sparkling water. I usually pay $100 to $150 for both of us for her birthday dinner. My birthday was 2 days ago. We went out. I drink, which my girlfriend doesn't like, and she thinks it's a waste of money. But it's my birthday, and she agreed to pay for everything. I had 8 drinks and a steak and dessert. dessert at a steakhouse, which cost about $200. With her $70 meal, it came to $310 with tips. She didn't say anything at the time, but last night blew up at me for drinking so much and expecting me to cover it. I defended myself because it was technically unlimited, and no, I wasn't drunk. I have a pretty high tolerance, so it's not fair. I can't enjoy myself. She's pretty frugal, so she thinks it's a crazy amount, and I was an asshole for leaving her with this high of a bill. We agreed we would pay for each other's meals and drinks, and it's not my fault she normally doesn't get more. It's your birthday. You can do what you want to.
Whoa!
You want 8 drinks? Drink away. You want steak and dessert? Whoa. You had an agreement. You had an agreement. Pay
no.
up.
No, you are the asshole in this situation. Are you kidding me? You know good. If y'all have been dating that long, you know what she can and cannot afford. Why would you want to push her to her limits financially? All right, $310 goes to pay car note. Probably goes to pay car note and to pay for car insurance, cell phone bill, and probably a little bit on the groceries. You cost her in one meal because you're selfish and greedy. You cost her two, potentially three different bills. No, you are the a-hole. Just because y'all have that agreement doesn't mean you should take advantage of it. You have been taking advantage. Stop it. No, I can't believe you of all people would side with this.
Well, okay, this is actually—
excuse my language, but this prick, that's a prick move.
This is actually funny because it's not the same situation, but my husband and I do the same thing. As everyone knows, we're a Venmo couple. We share everything. We're two only children. We still don't have a shared bank account. Whatever. It's fine. Get over it. We pay for each other's birthday dinners in totality. That's always a thing. But if we end up, this has happened like the last 3 birthday dinners we've been at. It's ended up being way more than either of us expected. We both drink, so you get like a cocktail to start and then a bottle of wine and then the meals. And it always ends up being so much that the other person has stepped in and said, let's just split this like we normally do because it makes it feel like less of a financial burden. So that is the nice thing to do. That said, I feel like this woman is more mad that the guy had 8 drinks on his birthday dinner and she's not drinking, and maybe there's some more underlying problems that therapy would help with. But it's his birthday. Like, not everybody is cool with Splitsville.
If you know she's uncomfortable with you drinking, why push the boundaries and grab 8 of them things? Why? You drinking 8 drinks is not going to make her more comfortable. You drinking 8 drinks and making her pay for it while you drink it is not going to make her more comfortable with you drinking and having fun. You're just doing things now to be annoying and aggravating, and she's 100% right and fair to be mad at you for that. Now, on top of the fact it's $310, are you kidding me?
I'm really not trying to walk back my original reaction to this, because my first step is, birthdays are a beautiful thing. Celebrate accordingly. You do you. Enjoy your birthday. But I do agree with what you're saying. And more than that, this gets into my, like, do couples not talk to each other? Like, stories like this just blow them up. They've been together 3 years and you don't know each other's financial, like, limits or your hard outs where you're sharing something because it makes it better. Like, how do you get in this situation? And from the guy's perspective, you're absolutely right. You know your girlfriend is gonna have this kind of reaction and you just do it anyway. You're like, F it, I'ma do me. And then you're upset about the upset reaction from her instead of trying to make it better. Again, just why aren't you talking about this at dinner? Hey, I wanna have 8 drinks. I know this is gonna be a little bit.
Hey,
I want
I'm
this.
I'm 2 drinks in, you got it. If I get another one, is that okay with you? You're paying. Can I get another one?
Right.
Can I get another one after that? And then let her be like, no, that's enough. That's how we do it. Because I pay for the food. The food is my bill. Food is, we do it. Everybody has a bill.
Sure.
So she got mortgage and I got health insurance and like, blah, 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 blah. I got the food bill. So whenever we go out, I pay. She always asks though, hey, I'm thinking about getting this. Is that cool? It's like, yeah. Or no. Right? Like, you got to talk through these things.
Right.
But how many relationships would you say are exhibiting healthy forms of communication?
And that's the problem. That's the problem. Like, this is so much deeper than this am I the asshole story. Like, just talk to the person you're with. Communicate. Capital C, communicate. It's not that difficult. Anyway, I wish them nothing but the best getting over this one, because that girl's going to remember that for a long time.
Somebody in the chat brings up the fact, like, the videos of the woman bringing a couple of friends to the date for birthday and then expecting the boyfriend.
Oh, that's insane. To pay.
Like, no, let me be clear. I don't side with that. This isn't a man-woman thing. This is a right thing. And we know that I'm a righteous person. I always stand on the side of righteousness and rightness. That is wrong also.
Yes, that is very wrong.
You can't expect me to pay for you and your friends because it's your birthday. No, I'm not doing that. And if you can't do that, don't be with somebody who expects that of you. Just leave her. I would get my happy ass up if the wife snuck that on me. I'd walk the hell out. I pay for mine, and I might pay for hers, and I walk out. God bless you. Good luck washing them dishes. I'm not paying for your food. Get out of here.
Can I do my magic trick?
Yeah, and then we can talk about my wardrobe.
And then we can talk about cicadas. Okay, I have a magic trick. I need you to be engaged.
Okay.
I need you to pick a number between 1 and 10. This goes for everyone. You don't have to say your number out loud. Just pick a number between 1 and 10. All right, you've got it. Number between 1 and 10. I now need you to multiply that number by 9. Multiply the number by 9, okay? Now I need you to take that number, if it is a two-digit number, if the number you are left with has 2 digits, I need you to add those 2 digits together. Got it? You've added the 2 digits together. Now subtract 5. Okay, subtract 5. And now convert that number to a letter in the alphabet. So if your number is 1, it would be A. If it's 2, it's B. If it's 3, it's C. 4 is D. 5 is E, and so on and so forth. Okay. You good? I need you to choose a country starting with that letter. Choose a country starting with that letter. Do you have your country?
Not yet.
Okay.
Naming countries is hard for me. I'm not okay. really good.
It's all right.
At
you can Google.
At geography.
Name a country that starts with that letter.
Gosh, you would think there'd be a ton of countries.
I can't.
I don't want to Google it.
Just Google it.
I don't want to Google it.
I believe in you.
You believe in me? Thank you.
Yes.
All right, go ahead.
You got a country?
Yeah.
Okay. Next up, I need you to think of an animal starting with the last letter of that country. So you picked the country. Spell it out, the last letter of that country. Now pick an animal that starts with that letter. You got one?
I'm much better with animals.
Okay, well, I know. Animals more your forte. All right. After this, you are going to take... Hold on.
I got to write this down.
Okay, I need you to take the last letter of the animal and think of a color that starts with that letter. Do you have a color that starts with the letter that is last in the name of the animal?
Hold on. Now I got to look up colors. Keep talking, Jessica.
Okay, colors that start with the last letter of the animal that you picked. Do you have one? Colors are so easy.
No.
Dang it.
I don't. Hold on.
I feel like you're going to fail this trick.
Yeah, I am.
Are you ready? Everyone out there?
I got it.
I'm going to say, okay. Did you know that there are no orange kangaroos in Denmark?
Let's go. Let's go.
Did you have it?
No.
Ah!
No. I was trying to.
Were you trying to beat my trick?
Unfortunately for you.
You know the trick?
I was trying to name a country other than Denmark.
Ah! Did you get one?
I could not think of a country other than Denmark.
I think Dominican Republic would have been good.
I knew there was a country over here.
Are there any other ones in Latin America?
What was the other one, Jacob? Dominican.
Djibouti would have been great.
Oh.
Democratic Republic of the Congo, formerly known as Zaire, of Zaire Williams.
My animal was...
Some also consider Germany because the German name for Germany is Deutschland.
I thought that was an actual country. Dang.
Oh, I'm so bummed that you tried not to get Denmark. When I did it, I fouled it up because I did koala instead of kangaroo.
That was my
and
other
so
one.
Mine was A, and then I did auburn as my color. So it was auburn koalas in Denmark. But Denmark, I was, and then I saw how it works, and I was like, wow.
This is real easy.
Isn't math cool?
Not really. Not really.
I'm mine so was excited.
My issue was with the animal. The animal ended in an E. I knew not to do kangaroo or koala because I couldn't remember which one, but it was a marsupial. I was like, okay, don't do one of those. I did killer whale. And so then I had to find an
that
E.
That would have been good too.
Emerald.
So, an emerald killer whale in Djibouti.
Oh, that would be perfect.
I would have loved an emerald killer whale in Djibouti. All right, everyone, thanks for going through that trip.
Speaking
with
of
me.
Djibouti.
It was very fun.
How about these fits?
Speaking of Djibouti, how about these cicadas? Am I right? Am I right? From the planet that brought you murder hornets and super pigs, this summer you could see zombie cicadas roaming the earth. That's right. Trillions of cicadas are set to emerge in what they are calling Cicadageddon, and some of them are infected by a sexually transmitted fungus that makes them hypersexual. So not only do you get trillions of cicadas coming to the earth, you're getting hypersexualized zombie cicadas. According to experts, the bugs will emerge in numbers not seen in decades. One brood is coming up, because that's what we call large groups of cicadas. They are broods. One brood is coming out of Georgia and the Southeast, and it should be seen here in Tennessee. Another is in Illinois, and once they come from the ground, they molt into adults, and within a week to 10 days, the fungus will cause the backside of their abdomens to open up, and a chalky white plug will erupt out, taking over their bodies and making their genitals fall off.
So then what happens? Why are they so sexual then if they don't have any genitals?
Because they keep trying.
Oh.
Yeah, they become obsessed with trying.
Okay. All right. I guess that's one way to do it.
Apparently, some people think that every summer we get these news of, oh, this is going to be the year that all the cicadas come out again. But this one is apparently the real deal. Cicadageddon.
Cicadas come through every now and then, and it depends on the year. I remember when I was a kid. Nashville, Clarksville, so I might have been 10 or 11. And we were splitting time between both. Like, the cicadas were out, and you couldn't drive down the street without just massive amounts of cicadas being slammed into your window. It was pretty gnarly.
Gnarly is the word. There's some concern that, like, animals are going to be gobbling up the cicadas with the fungus. And not all of them have the fungus. They don't know how many will be the hypersexual zombie cicadas just constantly trying to go at it. But if animals and snakes are to eat those, they don't know how it will impact other wildlife.
Yeah, that's not good.
And then if those, like, what if your little dog is out and John Calipari's walking you with his stroller and dog behind and the dog eats one of these hypersexual zombie cicadas, and then the dog becomes a hypersexual zombie, and then you have hypersexual dogs.
Don't we already have that? Aren't dogs just itching to hump things anyways?
That's why we cut off their things.
What things?
Their
use
genitals.
The words. Okay, thank you. Thank you. They cut off. So what do we do with the lady dogs? Are we cutting off their genitals? Their genitals aren't outward facing.
They get things tied.
What
tubes
tied? What tied?
Ovaries.
Okay. Wait, ovaries aren't the tubes. Ovaries are up top.
Correct.
The fallopian tubes, are we tying those?
How does neutering a dog work? Or is it spayed for women?
It's spayed for a woman?
Spayed.
Whoa.
I'm sorry, what do you want me to say?
Whoa. Say a what?
A bitch.
Like, Jessica, come on,
that's
man.
It's a female dog. I'm just being anatomically correct.
Golly.
How does spading a dog work?
I think they just stitch it up, don't they?
They remove their ovaries.
Okay, so they take the ovaries out?
Uterus and fallopian tubes.
Oh, so they just...
They just take it all
they
out.
They give them a hysterectomy damn near.
Yeah, why do we call it spading? It's literally just giving a dog a hysterectomy.
Wait, in a hysterectomy, are we taking out everything or are we just taking out the uterus? Because I think the tubes and the ovaries are still there.
It removes the uterus?
Yeah. Yeah, while you're looking at
the uterus.
Hey, Jacob, roll the clip from the fashion
show. No,
Jacob, roll that beautiful bean footage.
Do not,
Jacob,
no.
Let me be great, Jacob.
Don't do it.
I believe in you.
Don't
come on, kid.
I take responsibility for what comes on
Jacob.
The show.
She takes the responsibility. We're not getting in trouble.
From WTF? You want to know what I love from WTF?
What?
On the story list of things that we could talk about?
What?
The fact that Dawn Staley played with the twins that were in Disney's double team.
I forgot that.
They played together at Virginia.
I knew that. I remember thinking, that's how I know Don Staley. Don Staley played with the Double Team Twins.
Why is Don... We could remake Double Teamed with Don Staley. Who says no? One of the greatest Disney Channel original movies of all time. Do you think Don Staley shows her players the clip of the worst ISO ever to exist in a basketball movie?
It was incredible. That was very clearly a trap. We talked about the refs in the women's championship game. The refs in that high school championship game.
Some of the worst we've ever seen.
Terrible refs, because she was shoveling all of her feet.
All the feetsies.
Jacob, go ahead and roll that footage.
Nope, Jacob.
She's taking responsibility. Roll that footage.
Next up, there was a man who ran the length of Africa.
Was that people chasing him?
He was like Forrest Gump. Nobody's chasing him, and he just decided to run. He just said, I want to run. It was the equivalent of 385 marathons in 352 days. You think I need a lobotomy? Come on.
I'd rather run the length of Africa than watch week zero.
That's such a lie.
Eastern Michigan take on, give me another one of those teams, Troy State.
It's Troy. You do this all the time. Troy.
It's always going to be Troy State.
Of the Fun Belt, Sun Belt.
Yeah, whatever.
Okay?
Whatever.
Anyway,
Jacob,
Russ
roll
Cook
that
was the guy who ran the length of Africa. He said, I'm a little bit tired after he did it.
I'd imagine.
People who run are so annoying sometimes.
You run.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
It's annoying.
As long as you know.
No one really likes to run. I mean, I take that back. Like, I enjoy going on a run. It's nice. But once you reach a certain point, like, have you ever seen someone run a marathon and look comfortable about it? Like, they're proud. It's an accomplishment. But everyone talks about how miserable it is. Imagine running a continent.
Well,
if you could run any continent, what would you run?
What continent was the fashion show on? That's where I would run.
Oh, that's so interesting that you would say that. Everybody,
was that in Europe somewhere?
I hope you have a wonderful,
Jacob, roll
wonderful
the
rest of your Wednesday.
Jacob,
thank you for joining us. Thank you for story time and the magic trick.
Jacob, go ahead.
And suffering through D'Angelo Williams once again telling us that Dennis Rodman isn't as great as we all think he is.
Run it.
I hope you have a great rest of your Wednesday. It's a Grizzlies game day. Grizzlies Cavs tonight. 6
go
o'clock
ahead,
tip. Don't join late. Grizzlies, Cavs, Bally Sports Southeast. You only
We're
have three chances to watch the Memphis Grizzlies the rest of the way. Yes, we
Jacob,
forgot to do Wake Up Rob
she's
yet again,
take
but really, that's just
We're
a nice
fine.
Thing for us. Okay. Bye-bye now.
Jacob,
bye-bye.
The footage. Go, no. Jacob. No, that's the wrong thing, Jacob. Jacob, she said that she's going to take responsibility for it. We can't get in trouble for it. Also, what better way to celebrate the 1-year anniversary of the Corbin situation?